fuck, dude? Is this how we're going to start?
Dude. That's me, dude.
Is that how this,
hey, that's
is
me every time, dude.
And that's the start, huh? All right. Well, this is episode 63 of the podcast, the You Are Here podcast. I'm here with myself and Dave. I don't know why I said myself twice, but find the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube.com with that video, Anchor.fm, Google Podcasts, Podbean. We're bringing back Earworm. We're bringing back the Earworm. One, two, anyone? Earworm? Great name.
I'm going to name one. Earlobe.
All right, and www.youarehearpodcast.co. We cannot afford the end. We could not in these trying times. I don't know. Well, fuck. Already. We're gonna start off with a mandatory COVID-19 talk.
We're getting into it.
All right, We can make it like 10 minutes. I don't know. We're gonna see.
Short but sweet, dude. Because we're not gonna do the whole podcast.
All right, fine. All right.
Right.
So
is that fair?
Yeah. For sure. Because we're not that talented.
No, we don't need to talk about this virus.
Yes,
the whole podcast.
Yes, we can't. It's too much.
But it's
too much negativity.
We do talk about it because it is happening.
So let's start off with, we had a little Instagram live, right?
Yes.
We had a couple people chime in, ask some questions. I didn't write them down, so I'm hoping that you remember them.
I think I noted them. Hold on.
I remember my brother Sebastian. Big shout out. His was how are you coping with the COVID-19? So Japan's actually a little bit different with the whole like what they're doing to like prevent it and stuff. They actually like were like hiding it, not hiding it, but like they weren't testing and they weren't like taking it seriously because of like government, like some bullshit. And
really?
I'm throwing shots right now. I don't know why I'm doing this, but they're basically like, it's a very like tough, like the relationship between the government and people. And like they weren't fast to like kind of like enforce it or like
really?
Put like, I think today they just put in my brother said state of emergency in 7 prefectures, which is like kind of like states. But they just started that and like, I don't know, man, it's not good. And they keep releasing like every day, like, oh, like 200 new cases. But it's like, I don't know.
That's like us, dude.
It's scary, man.
That's like us.
Yeah, Jersey just hit 35,000. Yep. Ugh. And this is the positive talk we want right now, right?
Yeah, I know. We got to talk about it, though. We got to just get it out of the way.
What are we doing? What are you doing to cope?
What are you doing to cope? I'm playing Xbox a lot. Mm. I am messing around with
NBA 2K. I've never heard you say that.
I know. And when's the last time I played video games, dude?
Yeah.
For real.
I just started getting back into them because of this.
This is the only reason I play them. I have nowhere to go.
Yeah.
So I play 2K a lot. I started playing Call of Duty a bit. Mm. I started watching a lot of Netflix and 30 for 30 ESPN documentaries. Like Dennis Rodman's is awesome. Like 10 out of 10. Go watch that if you have ESPN.
He was wild.
He was insane, dude. But you leave that documentary like really feeling for him. Like I feel like I understand him.
Yeah. That's a legend.
Yeah, dude, a tough life. Mm. I've been watching Glee.
Glee.
You ever heard of that one?
I'm gonna be that guy. Really don't like Glee.
Dude, well, I started watching it. I'm into it. It's terrible TV, but like, I'm into it now.
Really?
I'm into it. I'm involved in the stories.
What do you like
Finn,
about Glee?
Finn is, you know, he's stuck in a love triangle right now. With his boy and his girl, I forget her name, Fiona or some shit, and she's pregnant, but from his homie, not from Finn. But she told Finn that it's his baby, so he's trying to raise this baby that isn't his, basically, before it's born.
Oh, really?
And the shoe's about to drop, you know, where the news.
You know,
comes
dude,
out.
I'm gonna take that back. I never even fucking tried watching Glee.
So take
so
it
I should
back,
probably
bro. I didn't
stop
try
talking shit. So I should probably just try.
So I'm into Glee right now, dude. Heavy.
I feel that.
Really?
I feel that. Hell yeah.
What are you doing?
Ooh. I just finished Modern Love.
Oh.
The series. Dude.
Yep.
The way that ties all back in together, bro.
Isn't it amazing?
I was like, you know, I gotta, this is going to connect to something else, but we can do it after the COVID talk. But okay. I've been watching Modern Love. I love that shit. Just playing games, Animal Crossing. I've been going on hikes, dude. This hike I went on yesterday,
yeah,
was Major.
Oh, I saw pictures you posted. Dude, it looked amazing.
I went. It's like Sterling Mine. It's kind of it's near us, but
okay.
Dude, I left at 4. I got back at 8 o'clock.
Wow, bro.
I was hiking for 3.5 hours, and
that's great.
And it wasn't even like it was like 9 miles, 1,500 like feet elevation, like.
Whoa,
dude! And there was like 3 mountains to climb. I'm like, dude, I'm dying. I was dying. It was really cool though. Like the trails. Yeah. I want to go to the and there's like a fire tower at the top of one mountain, and dude, you know I climbed that shit.
Did you,
dude? It said not to climb it, but dude, I climbed it.
Did you bring your camera?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Took some pictures. Yeah. That was it's crazy. Are you afraid of heights?
Kind of, but not really.
Dude.
Not like terrified.
I was shaking. I have like a pretty mild fear of heights.
Yeah.
But when I get up there, I just start shaking and I'm like, I was freaking out, dude. But like I sat there and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to like go to, I didn't want to go to the top. It's really high and it's on a mountain. So I was like, fuck, this is crazy. I'm literally like above the trees. Like, and I'm looking down like, this is insane.
Yeah.
I'll send you a video. But I was up there and I was like, I have this fear. Like, I just want to like kind of like attack it, you know? So I just, I just sat down at the top and like, I looked out and leaned over and like, I just like breathe. I kept breathing until like my heart stopped beating, like beating hard.
Well, you conquered a fear then. That's huge.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's conquered, but it felt easier to do.
In that one moment it was conquered.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
It
was, you stilled your breath. It felt good, man.
That's amazing, dude.
It was crazy.
That exercise is so important, dude. All we've been doing is running every day. We've been going on like these runs where like we'll knock like 3 miles out at like a pretty good pace. But I'll see like, you know, like 4 people on the run total, like walking around. And every time I see a person, like we're running down the same side of the street and they're coming to me and I'm coming to them. I just cross the street with Lena. Like we go to the other side of the road and just stay the fuck away. Did you see anyone on your hike?
Yeah. Even like hiking, like, I would be like going and then like they'd be like at least like 10 feet away and they would just like go to the side and wait for me.
Yeah,
to go.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm like,
step
all
away.
Right, sorry.
Yeah. Sorry. Sorry for my existence. I'm sorry. I feel weird about it.
I got like a compliment on the hike though. This guy stopped me and he was like, hey, he's like, you look like you take trails a lot and you like know what you're doing. Like, do you know where this like fire tower thing is? I'm like,
oh, wow.
I was like, this is the first time I've been here. But I was like, all right, I look like a trailblaze. I feel that.
Yeah, dude.
So that was
That's fun. Awesome. So that's what you've been doing.
Yeah, that's kind of the only things really to do.
Yeah.
What else can we do? Like, I don't know.
Watch movies. Yeah. Did you see in the Love show? Did you see that moment I told you about with the birth?
With the kid?
Whew. Did you watch it?
Dude. With the gay couple and the kid, right?
Yeah.
Oh my god, bro. And I love the guy that what's it called? The one parent that wanted to like that didn't really like wasn't sure about the kid, but like he was the one to be there and like go through it all.
I love it, man. How incredible is that guy?
So good, man. Fuck.
That show killed me, dude.
Talk about other shit to do. We gotta start writing and like doing shit. I've been making like a beat every day. So, which is good.
Have you?
Good for me.
Oh, good.
Feels good.
Good.
I've been learning a little bit. Still ripping on the guitar. Just trying to practice a little bit.
Yeah.
Other than that, it's kind of been... I've just been cycling that. And it's like... Some days I just like play a game till like... I wake up at like 12. I play a game till like 5. And I make food. I'm like, I suck.
I started reading my Marlon Brando book again. I think it's called Somebody. Mm. I think the last Marlon Brando book that came out so far, but it's been amazing, dude. Like, I think that is bringing me back to like, a sense of like creativity, like sitting down and reading that book once a day for like an hour, half hour, whatever I get to, like in the beginning of the day, like with coffee, I'll crack open the book and that's starting to make me feel like creative again a little bit. Like the energy starting to come into me a little bit. And I'm like, okay, like you're not a loser. You're not a piece of shit. Like, because you're not writing something right now, like you're not acting in something, like just read and enjoy your book. And like the book is bringing me a lot of closure and a lot of like inspiration and positive energy.
Good.
The act of reading. Yeah.
I want to give you a task every week for this podcast.
God.
Come on.
I feel anxiety just hearing the word
really?
Task. dude. Yeah.
Just, I feel like it's not, it won't be too bad.
Okay.
I want you to write one poem every week.
Oh, done. Okay. I can do that. That's right? Good. That's positive. Yeah. I like that.
Come on. That's not too bad.
I'll do that.
That was a good one.
I'll do that.
I feel
that. I'll do that for sure. Yeah.
I missed some Dave poems.
I'll do that. That's awesome. I'll do that. And then you got to have a task too. Then.
Don't give me a task.
Let's do, you have to, by next week, come to me with, I want to make it easy. I don't want to like make it a tough mountain to climb. I want it to be like a casual first week. Like
Beat every week. What?
A premise of the film that you want to make. Like a premise. Like just a, that's it.
I like that. I'll do that.
Just like a one sentence premise. Like that's it.
Yeah, yeah. Just like a feeling or something.
Yeah, anything. If it's like the Boy Who Cried Wolf, the premise would be like lying leads to ruination. Like that's the premise of the story. That's what you get after watching the story. Damn. Or hearing about the story, reading.
All right.
So just the premise. Like what story are you trying to tell? Like that's it. You don't even have to have details about it. Just what is happening. Yeah. What's happening in the story?
Okay. Damn, I like this.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So there we go. Task time.
Task time.
But easy tasks.
We need some tasks for the viewers, man. We need some.
Yeah.
What can we have for like people to do?
People who are listening right now to the podcast, thank you again for tuning in for real.
I know it's probably tough to, I don't know.
I get a lot from doing this, dude. And it's, me too. I'm glad like people like listen during this time. Like,
Shout out Michelle. She has some nice words.
Shout out Michelle. Shout out Leilani. Shout out everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
We love you. And we're going to make it through this. But let's keep leaning on each other. This is really cool that we still do this. I feel like it's good for me. I need this.
Oh, yeah. For me too.
What were you saying? What should we do? Tasks for people who are... I don't know. I think it's person to person. What could be one thing? So, okay. Hit us up with one thing that you've done this week that you haven't done before due to either being stuck inside or whatever. How about that?
Or I want
to write back to us.
Or like, what was like? I kind of want to ask this to you too.
Go ahead.
What was your favorite thing that happened? Like just like a moment or anything
so far?
Yeah, like when once all this happened.
I think a big one was the mountaintop moment, dude.
Really?
Yeah, I think that was big for me.
Go through that. That a little bit.
When you took us on a hike, you took me and Lena on a hike, and it was kind of like out in the middle of nowhere. And you're like, it's pretty good hike. And I don't think I've ever been to a summit like that. But we were like climbing pretty steep. I was getting, you know, pretty tired, out of breath, and like sweating a bit. And I was like, man, we gotta be close, huh? And you're like, yeah, it's a little bit further. And I was like, okay, fuck. Like I was feeling pretty negative until like the clearing opened up. And then like it was just blue sky, white clouds, eagles soaring around me, stone on the top of the summit, and people were like, some people were kind of laying on it. There was only a couple people, and we picked like another different stone to lay on. It was like this giant slate, and me, you, and her were just like sitting there looking around at all of this greenery, and the sky was like an ocean, and it just met the greenery, and eagles were flying around, and it was so peaceful, and the clouds would cover the sun. And you feel the cloud covering the sun, and the cloud would pass, and you feel the sun hitting you again. There was like no noise other than the wind, and that's it. Like that's it. It was just so peaceful, man. And there was nowhere to go. There was nowhere to be. Nothing to do. It was like a moment where I was so present and so grateful to be where I was that I was like, oh, dude, if it's over right now, like, I'm good. I'm not even thinking about a virus or like, I'm not thinking about all the shit, the bad shit that's going on in the world that I see in the news and around me. I'm just happy to be here on this rock, like on top of this mountain with you guys, with just who I was with. And that was a big moment, man. That gave me a lot of like, I feel like there's a tank in me, like a gas tank. And like that, someone like poured more gasoline in the tank for like a couple weeks, you know, that was a good one.
Hell yeah.
That was big.
Do you think, I feel like sometimes people say like when they go back into nature and stuff, they just feel like rejuvenated and like in a way.
Oh,
like,
totally.
Do you think that kind of happened? Like, do you think like primally that's kind of like what we need?
I think sometimes. So. I think so.
You just got to connect.
If
back.
You look around now, do you see people like walking outside, like trying to just walk with their kid outside or like walk their dog or whatever? Yeah. I see people just walking outside, fishing.
Yes.
In Jersey, you kind of can still, like, you got to be careful, but like, you can if you stay away from people because there's not a lot of people outside. But you see people who I don't think you would see before getting outside because they're fucking scared or they're having trouble inside the house because there's no work. There's nowhere to get out to go do a thing. You can't really do that. And instead of being stuck in your house all day, there's this primal call in me for sure to be like, can we go out and run?
Yeah.
I'm going to walk the dog. Like anything to just get fresh air. It makes me feel better by the time I get back inside. Like when I'm opening the door to come back inside, I'm like, okay, I feel better than when I open the door to leave for sure.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It's crazy how, like, I thought about this the other day when I was at the cafe job and I was working and I was alone. And like, I do this thing where I just like, I don't want to sit in the whole time. And it's not that busy that I can I usually leave the door open just so I get like fresh air.
Uh-huh.
And like I prop it open and I just like walk out and I look around and like I remember just going out one time and there was these kids that just had like bikes and they were like it was a little group of like friends and they were like biking around like just having fun and I was like I don't remember the last time I even saw like kids doing that you know what I mean because I feel like now it's been not with like with this new generation stuff it's kind of more like staying in like playing games or
yeah,
I don't know. I remember when I was younger, like there was a point where I would like be outside with my friends all the time, like biking.
Me too.
Like just playing outside, playing frisbee. Yeah. Like I don't know, just being outside. And like it's always like your parents would go outside, you know, and do like goose hunting. I remember every time it was like my one best friend, shout out Skyler Baldwin.
Shout out.
I think he's out in Vermont right now, but I remember his parents were those parents, like I would always, he'd be like, oh, come over. And then like we would go on a computer for like 10 minutes and his parents would be like, get outside, like go do something. And we'd just like go in the woods and like run around.
Yeah.
And like, I remember there's this one road near where I live and it would be the road that I would bike on all the way to my friend's house. And it's like, it's literally like 3 miles. It's like terrible. Sure. Cause like I live like in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
And I remember I used to do this every day. And I remember I saw there's this one, like in the middle, there's like this shortcut. If for me to bike all the way to my friend's house, it's literally, I have to bike the whole 3 miles. But if I go through this like trail in the woods, it literally cuts like the last 2 miles out. His house is but it's like a big property of like this like big house and you like have to go around it. And I remember there would always be a dog and I would sprint and like run away from the dog. But like, I don't know, it's just like those kinds of stories and things, like I don't know, there's such like little kid like innocent stories.
Yeah,
I just like saw that and I was like, wow, I used to do that and I just forgot about all these things.
You forgot about it, right?
Yeah, I don't know, it's just, like, nice when you like,
it is nice.
I think this has been kind of like bring people out more. Definitely. And, like, I get to see like that kind of, I don't know, side of the world again.
Nice. The quarantine has brought more people out, which is crazy, but it's true.
Yeah,
I think like I was running before, I think yesterday or 2 days ago with Lena, and there was like bikes. There was like 3 or 4 bikes on a front lawn, like laid out.
Yes.
Oh. And I was like, dude, that was the marker.
Yes.
It came back to me in a wave. Like that was the marker.
Yeah,
of, like,
man.
My friend was at his crib, and like this was his house.
Yeah.
And I would ride my bike up, and there'd be two other bikes there, and I'd be like, oh shit, Jason and Joe are here today, and I'd be like, oh man, this is crazy. Or someone be there, someone's bike, I'd be there, I'd be like nervous to be around, and I'd be like, ah, shit. I thought it was just gonna be me and my homie, but now fucking Greg's here, you know? Fuck, like, you know.
Damn,
like, I wasn't ready to see Greg. It brought back some of those memories.
Yeah.
Like, riding my bike and like seeing the bikes on the front lawn. And
yo, how rude is it to be a kid, dude? When you go to and you go to a friend's house, you like pull up in the back of your bike, you go through the back door. You wear your shoes and don't go in.
Shit to the parents. Yeah,
parents
yeah.
must hate that shit.
I know, dude. No, I used to be super respectful. I would like go inside and like talk to my friend's parents and sit down with them. Before I'd sit down with them for like 15 minutes before I even saw my friends. Yeah.
A lot of like my friends out here had like very like lax parents and very like they just let them do whatever the fuck. So sometimes I walk in and I'm like, I can't do this at my house. I don't know what's going on. Like, this is crazy.
I know, my mom would freak if I did something like that. If I brought someone in just like and said like didn't say anything, my mom would freak.
Yeah. Man.
Yeah. Yeah, I wasn't like that though.
That was a nice little reminisce.
I got one more thing from Nick. Nick brought up a question for us. Nick Craven, shout out.
Big shout out.
I miss you, dude, terribly. He said, what do you think the impact of this will be on society, like after all this is wrapped up? Like what impact will COVID have on society and the way we function after all this wraps up? What do you think, Mikey?
I think we touched on it a little bit in the past podcast. Mm-hmm. I just think it'll really make people real. Like, I think one thing that like I saw already is like, so my family's kind of in the process of like selling their house and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I thought about that, like how like maybe like economy will change or like market will change. And maybe like, I think people, we still have people like looking and like wanting to come over here and like look at that, like even through all this, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think people are going to realize like living in like New York City, like that's the worst place to have like an outbreak of anything, man. You're trapped. Yes. You can't go anywhere. You need a bus, a train. Like there's no way out of it. You know what I mean? Like that's the most dangerous shit ever. Yeah. You're basically stuck in your apartment like forever. And your apartments cost how much? How can you even, like to afford that shit? Like it's the worst place for like the worst case scenario. You know, I think people are going to be like looking at, I don't know, states more like in the Midwest and stuff.
You think
and
so? Yeah.
I think people are going to start being like, maybe we should like, I don't know, move out a little bit, have like a base like somewhere else.
Yeah. Because
you're kind of more safe like out like somewhere like here. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think for sure. I think the people more that are struggling with this, I mean, everyone is, but like, people who are going through it, like losing family members or,
yeah, man,
you know, nurses that are seeing the ER fill up like crazy. Like there's going to be some kind of PTSD after this where people, you know, I don't think it's going to be like, oh guys, it's okay to go outside. Like the government said, it's all good. So go ahead. And we're just going to be like, yeah, all right, back to normal. Awesome. This is sick. I think there's going to be like a time, I don't know how long it's going to take to go back to like even giving people hugs when you see them or handshakes or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know.
Like, how are you how can you trust like after all the shit is over, like people aren't going to like, are you going to like hug anymore? Or like, I don't know. Like,
I don't know, dude. I don't know. Handshakes. I don't know if there's going to be new systems put in place to like not touch money or exchange money. I don't know. My mind's running crazy, but like I don't know. I think it's going to create new hygiene like standards for sure. We're going to be way more conscious about like how close we speak to people and how even with vaccines, I feel like it's still going to be around. Like it's still going to be a thing that can be passed around. I feel like I don't think you can eradicate it.
Yeah.
But
you want to move into, I think someone asked about conspiracies. Some COVID conspiracies. Geez,
yeah.
I know a couple of them I read about. I'll start
with... Wait, what'd you hear?
So I heard this one person was saying how like, you know how people give their take on things?
Yeah.
They were connecting take. Like the corona to like chicken pox. And you know what would happen with chicken pox? Or no, not with chicken pox, with smallpox.
Smallpox.
You know what happened with smallpox?
What happened?
Basically, it was like a epidemic where... the way that like the whole everyone had it, you know, it was like killing everyone. It was terrible. Oh. You know, it was a huge outbreak. It was spreading to everywhere around the world. They literally had to have like a world, like the world come together and like do like a like what would you call it, like come together to basically like beat it. I forgot the word for it, but it's like a scientific thing. Okay. Where everyone like goes and like they get it, and then they I think they found that the there was a disease to like combat it or something, and so they would have that, and it would be like the counter to all that shit. And I think that's some way connected to chicken pox. And people are like, it's gonna be the same as this, like, you know, we're all gonna have to get it, we're all gonna have to go through it and have this counter whatever strand or some shit. Mm-hmm. Another thing I've been hearing is Bill Gates started everything.
Have
you heard that?
Yeah.
That he wants to like control everything. They projected like some government official like in the disease prevention unit or something predicted like a virus like Corona to hit, and they predicted this like 3 years ago, and how like they could implement a system to like combat it, like best case scenario, like before it spreads to everything. And like everything they listed was like the exact like definition of what coronavirus is. Mm-hmm. And like it was funded by like the Bill Gates, I don't know, commission or some shit. I don't know. It's so stupid. People are just fishing.
I heard that this was created in a lab in a
oh yeah.
Like a virus pandemic lab.
Yeah.
War lab in Wuhan. And I'm like
to get rid of all the old population. Because there's so many.
Just to wipe everyone out.
Oh my god, dude.
Yeah.
Another thing, I just want to say, anyone that is like, I've heard people say this about how it only affects old people.
No, dude. It doesn't.
Even that statement. Are you an idiot?
100%.
Yeah, really. Just get rid of all the old people. They're gonna die anyway, right?
100%. That when you say that. I think that's one of the most careless things you could say.
I get it. A lot of people are making a joke, right? But it's like,
yeah,
I don't know. That's a little fucked up. Don't be one of those.
I don't know. I see a lot of young people that like still meet up, still hang out. Oh, yeah. Still like,
and they're like, it's not, well, I'm not hanging out.
Yeah. A group of like 10 young people, like high schoolers and shit. And they just chill. And I'm like, I get not caring because it's not affecting you, but that's such a selfish thought. That's such a selfish thought because you can take time away from a person's life. Like put yourself in blink and be like 80 years old. And like, you're trying to just stick this out and make it through this pandemic. And you're terrified. I see it on the people's faces outside here. Like they want to go outside to get some sun, but like they're afraid to. They don't know what the virus is, how it's even transferred, and they're afraid to be touched by it because they don't want to fucking die. And like, no one really does. And that's not fair to them to be like, it's only old people. Like, you're going to be old one day if you're lucky. And, you know, if that was you, would you want a young person to look at you and say like, oh, fuck them. Like, let's go hang out.
The crazy shit too is these people that get it can't see their fam. They can't see anyone.
No, dude, they're dying alone, bro.
Well, they're
dying alone.
Our Corona minute has turned into Corona hour.
I know, bro. Last thing I'll say on this stuff.
Yeah.
You get it. And if it's for the worst, like if you're on the decline, the process I've heard so far is if you're lucky, you get put on a ventilator.
Yeah.
And it ravages your lungs and it damages them for life, or you're dying and they tell you you're going to die. And then you have to FaceTime your friends and family because they can't even see you and you die saying goodbye on a phone or through a screen. Like, that's no way to go, man. This is not a cool thing. This is fucking terrible.
Yeah. It's serious.
So do what you can. Do your part, man. Do your
part. Stay inside.
My thing is this, though. Don't get on each other. People stop yelling at each other and shit. I see a lot of people like yelling at people. That's no way to get to somebody. Just, you know. They know, everyone knows what to do. Everyone knows to just stay inside as much as you can. Be super safe if you go outside, if you have to. But take care of yourself, take care of the people around you. And that's it. And we're all in this together. There's no way around it. You can die at 19 with this thing. You could die at 85. It's killing everyone. Or it's, you know, it has the potential to kill anyone. So just take it serious. But my advice would be like, like, let's not turn on each other and let's not rip on each other, and you know, everyone take it serious. That's all.
Yeah.
What's your favorite moment that's happened, like being with the change of everything? Like, what's been like your one moment? Because I said mine.
Oh, true. Definitely. I'm trying to like. I feel like there's really not that many spectacular points, but I think. I think maybe that hike I did yesterday and like that fear conquering felt really good. Like, I don't know, just doing something like that. It was something I've been wanting to like get better at, just like, I don't know, hike. And my thing has been like, I want to do like longer and like higher, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm like looking at like this app that like you track the elevation and like the miles and everything.
Is that All Trails?
Yeah.
That's our sponsor. That's our new sponsor.
Oh, yeah. Oh, fuck. But I remember this one was just like, I don't know, man. It just felt good to be up there and do it. And like, I climbed on this thing. I went up. I was like freaking out, like yelling. And like, no one was around. I, like, you're quiet and just, you don't hear anything. And I'm looking out. It's like sunset. Beautiful. I'm like, this is amazing. There's like a lake over there. There's like a bunch of mountains over there.
Yeah.
I climbed down. I ripped my pants on the thing. It's okay. It's cool. No. It's cool. You know, it's cool. But
which part down the seam, like in the inseam, on the, in the crotch or the back? Or
the perfect middle of the crotch.
Oh, it always rips there, yeah, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the spot. It always rips there.
You know what? I don't care. Who cares?
A quick story. I was in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. My grandparents took me there because I'm such a nerd. When I turned 16, they bought me, like, they rented a cabin.
Oof.
So we went to Gettysburg, where like the Civil War, when major battles of the Civil War was fought, a lot of the major battles. And we went out into this battlefield. It was called Little Round Top.
Mm.
And it was like a little like rocky hill, right? And like one side of it was like cliffs with rocks, and then the other side, and like you kind of jump from rock to rock if you felt like it, like a billy goat. And there was like a little wood fence like caught in this rock, like pretty like 10 yards below me. And I was like, fuck it. I'm going to go touch this fence, dude. This looks like a Civil War fence. Like, I want to get a piece of this wood or something. And no one was going to it. Everyone was checking out the monuments and stuff. And like wherever you died in the Civil War, like if you were a general or some kind of like high up lieutenant, they would make a monument of you where you laid in the battlefield, where they found you. Oh, wow. So you'd, like, you'd be walking through a field or you'd be driving through and there'd be nothing, just green. And all of a sudden you see like a little like a headstone and be like, oh, this is where someone fell. And you could go read their name or whatever. It was crazy.
Wow.
But in this spot, this little round top spot, I was jumping around like a billy goat trying to get to this wood fence. And I got to it. I got a piece of it. And I was like, look. I showed my grandparents. They were all excited for me and shit. I was like, this is the coolest day of my life. I was such a nerd. And then I jumped to go back. And as I like spread my legs to jump from rock to rock, I was wearing these fucking like whitewashed, like thin ass Hollister jeans that had rips in them already.
Dude,
down the where your junk is at, like straight down, like a perfect U into the leg.
No.
And wide open, dude. Like it was like flapping open. And up through the ass, too. So my whole shit was blown out.
Dude.
And I was just like, blown out ass, blown out front. And like there's like 40 tourists at the top of this like big, little round top. And I was like, Grandpa. I ripped my fucking pants. We gotta get out of here. Like, we gotta get out of here. We gotta get to the car. We gotta get out of here. And I was like, just like pinching my legs together, dude, just shuffling to get to the car, bro. I was so embarrassed, dude. Top 10 embarrassing moments.
Holy shit. Do you want to know something? Oh, wow. I've been keeping this for so long.
Okay, good.
This is a podcast moment.
Oh, I love it.
Dude.
Go ahead.
I don't think I told you this.
No, I don't think you told me. No.
Bro. One of the first couple podcasts.
Yeah.
I ripped my pants.
No way.
And I hit it. I fucking hit it.
Wait, dude.
I gotta find the episode.
What episode?
It's
Oh, my heart.
Dude, I fucking hit it.
Wait, dude. How? If we were sitting, how?
And it was like, it was like completely like, it was
terrible. Didn't notice it. I was just sitting there talking.
I was wearing a long shirt.
Wait,
I gotta find
it.
Give me 2 seconds.
It was one of the first 10 episodes. One of the first 10.
It was like one of the first 5, dude.
When it ripped, what did you do?
Dude, I was, you know what it was? I think I dropped something. Like going up the stairs and it just fucking ripped. Which one was this? This was dude.
That's so funny.
It's I think episode 7.
Episode 7?
Yes.
Was there a guest or was it just us?
Dude, you see how I'm like covering? No, it was just
wait,
us.
Dude. Wait,
you see how I'm sitting?
Wait, can you pull it up on here so that I can watch it with you?
Yeah. Screen share here. Like, can share the screen really quick. Dude, that is so funny.
I gotta see this. I gotta see this moment. This is big, dude.
All right, you see?
Yeah, I see you here. Yeah.
Look how I'm sitting.
this was story time.
Look how I'm sitting, dude. Dude, it's like, wait, it's like,
your
it's like
shirt is in there.
This whole, yeah, dude, I put my shirt down. I put those things over.
Was your left leg there?
It was like in the, it was, did you see that? Did you see that?
No, bro. Go back.
Ready? Wait for it. Look at my face. I was checking if it was, here, give it a second. I was checking. See? I checked. Oh, there it is. Yo.
You just, I turned away, looked at the phone.
Look how I'm sitting, bro. Look how I'm sitting. I'm playing it slick, dude. I'm playing it slick. Oh, my God.
That is incredible. Incredible.
Well, there's a little, there's a little Easter egg from the podcast.
That's amazing, dude. You ripped him on your way up the stairs?
Yeah, dude. I was so pissed. Had some tight pants, dude. Those are, I always rip my favorite pants, dude.
Those were your favorite?
My favorite pants.
It's always the favorite, dude. It's always the
favorite. If that happened on the day that I had like that deer incident, that would have been that would have been awful. Imagine.
Yeah.
I would have been so angry.
Yeah, dude. What are we at time wise right now? What are we looking at?
37 minutes.
How many?
37.
Okay, good. So we're past COVID talk. We were way over COVID talk. We're past.
Yeah, we did like 30 minutes of that.
I'm getting asked if we're almost done with the podcast because we got to watch Glee. But I want to talk about some real shit.
Damn, some bro. Good things. That's fucked.
Yeah, I know. We're in deep, dude. I got to get back to it. What could we talk about right now?
I wanted to throw in, what was it? From the Modern Love.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Bring that up.
From Modern Love. It was, fuck, what was it? Just like the, those last couple, if you haven't watched it already, please just watch Modern Love. It's on Amazon Prime. If you got Amazon, you can just watch it for free. But I just love, like, the relationships with, like, the, between the two old people. I feel like that would have hit you, like, hard. It was, like, the old lady that was, running, and she, like, found this guy that she was running with and, like, fell in love with him. She's, like, an old lady. You know what I mean? It's like I've never thought about, like, older love.
Well, this is based on all true stories too, right? Modern Love is based on all true stories that were written to the New York Times. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just that like idea of like it, the whole thing of the episode is just like there can be love after, you know, living life, marriage, like your partner passing and all this, you know, like, but after like, what are you left of being alone? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like,
that's true, man.
Going, that's and, like, true. The way the lady like, when her her son would like come in and she would like kind of like fake that she was like she wasn't feeling good or something, and she was kind of hiding like her life away from like her family, but then she was out to do like these things that she wanted to do, because maybe if she like told that to those people that they wouldn't like let her do it or something, but that's where she found like the love that she always wanted. And then him, the it's an old Japanese man, dude. That's the saddest thing in the world already.
I know, bro.
The old Japanese guy is so sad. If you picture that man just alone in a room, that's probably the saddest thing. If you ask me what the saddest thing is, it's probably that.
Probably an older Japanese
man. Just sitting in a chair, just like burp. You know what I mean? That's the saddest image I've had.
How about you saw, oh my God, why can't I think of the movie? Father was an architect. He dies. Guy, Columbus. You saw that.
Columbus.
You saw Columbus.
Did I? Is that the one with Emma Watson?
No.
What? Oh, that's Columbia.
That's
my bad.
That's Harry Potter, dude.
That's Columbia. Fuck you, dude. I don't think I saw Columbus.
You saw Columbus, 100%.
No way. All right, so what about Columbus?
Older Japanese man. I believe he's Japanese. He might not be Japanese. But,
No, I never watched this.
There's a shot in the film. Like, you never meet the father, but you see him from, like, really, really wide shots, and he's alone most of the time. He's an architect.
Oh, no, I did watch this.
Yeah, you watched it.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, fuck.
Wasn't that amazing?
Yeah.
He was Japanese. But I felt sad for him, like, being – even though you don't meet him, like,
yeah,
you know he's alone, and you know he's, like – really well renowned, but like living in the middle of nowhere, Columbus, like, I don't know. And the shots they framed him with that one green chair. Yeah. You remember that green chair shot?
Yeah.
And like he's in it, and then it's like his hat is in it, and then like nothing's in it. And I was like, oh, dude, it's the same shot three times, but like, I don't know. It got me, man.
I felt like it always felt like his father was like watching through in the buildings or something. Yes. You know what I mean? Like, yes. From above.
That's a really haunting and beautiful film.
Yeah. Columbus.
Columbus is a film to see. And that director is like top three of people I want to work with. That dude is
really
the
hell
shit.
Yeah. That's awesome.
I forgot his name. He's got one name. He's like Cher. He's like Madonna.
I can pull it up really quick.
Pull that thing up. Pull his name up.
Columbus.
That's my.
Kogonada.
Kogonada?
Yeah.
Kogonada. I'm putting it on the podcast now.
That's dope.
I'm going to work with you one
That's
day. Kogonada.
Oh, he's Korean.
And my dream.
He's Korean. I think it's a Korean film, actually.
It is. Korean.
The guy's Korean. Yeah. That's a really good fucking film. I never heard of this guy.
Incredible. That dude has studied film theory for like years and years and years.
Really?
About how films are made, all types of films. And he does journal, like film journals about them.
Really?
Created like a ton of film journals. And then this was his first like feature.
Wow. That's wild. He
crushed it.
Shit, man.
Yeah, dude. Who's one person you want to work with really, really bad? After all this clears up, like if you were to put one on the podcast right now, that in the future you'll look back on.
I think with like a director, it'd probably be Edgar Wright.
Yeah,
that's like I don't know, just to make something fun, man.
That is such your lane, like Edgar Wright stuff.
Yeah,
Edgar Wright is dope. He is dope.
The way he connects just like every like different worlds and like subcultures together, like I don't know, it's just like he does it well.
Yeah,
he does it very well.
Oh, I need Kogonada, Mike Mills, and like Fincher, dude.
Mm.
You know, that'd be terrible to be on a Fincher set because he shoots like 50 shots a shot. 50 takes
I would
a
like
shot.
That
would
I
you like that?
I love that kind of thing.
I heard he does it because the first few takes, like you've been on sets like where you get like six takes or something. Mm. That's like six, seven takes is like really normal. And like usually like people go in with an idea or people go in like really full and then you get like the like explosion moment and you catch it on tape and it's like second take, and it's like awesome. And then by takes five, six, seven, it's like kind of it's lived in. It might be losing its energy, you know. You might be people start to fade. I start to fade. Now imagine like going through the fading process like 20 times, and then the evolution of like by take 40, you found a whole new thing in the scene, like for the actors, and you're catching like a brand new moment you couldn't think of, but because you rehearsed it 40 fucking times in a row per shot. Like that's crazy.
Yeah. Would you like to work like that or?
Yeah, that'd be grueling as fuck, but like I am super curious about what I'd do in that kind of situation.
Like if you have the time,
he catches so much beautiful shit in his films.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Like if you can, he always, oh my god. I remember I just like thought back to the when he did what's it called? Mindhunter.
Oh,
oh
yeah.
Oh my god, man. It's just like beautiful. But
so good.
I think if you have the time to do that, like I remember in one of my, when I was in college, like I had like a web series kind of class, and like some of the people I was like working with, you're kind of put together in this one class and you just make like a web series. And I remember like a lot of people, like when you have extra time, like let's say you get a shot and you're like, all right, that's like a buy. You know what I mean? Like we can use that, but like people don't want to like work on it more. You know what I mean?
Yeah. They're done.
You know, like 2-3 takes. I'm like I can get a, if it's just like a normal take and you have extra time, people are like, let's just rap, you know, like I don't want to do it.
Yeah.
And you start seeing people, especially if you're like director or you're like DP, you start seeing people being like, all right, in the corners, like, you know, ready to like leave. Yeah. You're like, all right, dude, what the fuck?
Do you want to be here or do you not want to be here, dude? I hate when it's like you're on a set and somebody doesn't want to be there and you know it. Like that's the worst.
Yes. Cause that's in the back of your mind. It's, you can never get it out of your head.
You have one person like that on like an intimate set where it's like, 10 people or less.
Yeah.
And it's, you're in trouble, man. Cause you're worried.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I remember I had to direct and DP like one episode for the web series. I think it was the first one. But it was I remember like I was doing this entire like built set like inside of like our like studio room, and like I designed it, whatever, we built it and everything, and I had like a shot list and everything, and I always like write everything out and I plan it just so I have time to like get extra shit that I like, or like I don't know, more like experimental creative shit. And like I just remember like there was like a good amount of extras, like maybe like 10 like 15 extras, and you just see them like I don't know, like one by one start sneaking out or like shit like that. You're like, what the fuck, man?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's just like I enjoy sitting there doing those takes over and over. I don't know, I enjoy it.
You enjoy that? Yeah, because you're making a film, man.
Yeah,
that's the process of making a film. I don't mind it. Like it can definitely get grueling, but there's like,
I get the other side though, with like especially for the actors. I think after like even throughout this whole podcast and like meeting you and learning more about acting like that, and maybe like kind of like feel what the actors feel.
Yeah, you know? It's not easy, but like you do whatever you got to do to get the shot. Like they're like with Carl and Jordan, like they never like rush anything. You know what I mean? Like everything is get the shot. That's the most important thing, no matter what it takes. But like, if we get it, we can move on. Like we can save time for the next thing set up and we can move on. And like, we only have 3 days. So let's make sure by Sunday we have everything done and we only have to shoot one fucking thing and then we're golden.
Yep.
So I get the moving, you know, forward and not doing 50 fucking Fincher takes for like a short film. That's a little excessive, but it would be cool to see. Like, it would just be cool to experiment and see what happens after the 48th take.
Yeah.
And you might have two takes of magic, and like it's worth it. You know, two totally different takes. But like the one take with Carlotta, I think was one of the first times. It was the one where we had to lay down after she has like that episode. I carry her into the bedroom, and like we have to lay down and we talk to each other. It was like the first time. First time on a set, I think I felt like my stamina, like there's like this energy, I call it stamina, where like you fade pretty quick if you do a lot of takes, and if you like acting, it takes a lot of energy. Filmmaking in general takes a lot of energy, but like I know it seems super like easy and effortless, but like acting is, there's a lot of energy you put into that, a lot of like care and a lot of like emotional energy spent each scene and each moment, and really being present sometimes takes a lot of energy. So by like take eight, if there was like, we were setting up four different shots and like, or three different shots or whatever it was, by like the, I don't know, 20th take, I was like, I could do this shit all day. I can do this all day. If we guys want to go get lunch, I'll keep doing the scene all day. I don't care. Like it was that kind of moment where I felt I could do it forever. I was like, I could keep doing this. I just keep doing this, because we were finding new things every time, and I felt locked in the zone. But it was a cool moment. It was like a growing moment. I felt like I grew.
Nice.
And like it's a confidence thing too. Like once you, because I didn't know I could do that before, and then like you go on a set, you try a new thing, and you're acting, and it's such like a weird, ethereal, magical thing, like craft, that you, it's all like, it's all like you do work beforehand and then you got to let it go. And I tell you this all the time, but like you let it go and then you're present in the moment with another human being. And then some of the work that you did comes out in magical ways with the other person in an exchange or whatever you're doing in the moment, something comes out of you and like you capture it on film or whatever in the theater, people watch it. But like you start with not a lot of confidence in like, can I be present and like something come out of me, like can I do this for eight takes, like and not lose my presence and not lose my truth and not lose the person in front of me and not lose what I have to get done and let it all be real as if it's the first time. Like no way. A few years ago, like no way. 10 years ago, no fucking way. But like you do it not knowing you can, and you actually, it comes out of you and you did it, and then you're like, oh, I can do that. Then the confidence is built and you work from there. And like the next thing you do, you know, you do that and it's a new thing and you have to prepare a new way, or at least a new, you prepare however you prepare. But like you had that experience. So like you're confident in yourself, more confident, you know?
Yeah.
Weird.
I think it's awesome to share that too, and for people to hear that.
Yeah.
And like kind of how, in a way, you kind of find like you're like a leg in this whole, you know,
for sure.
Beast. You know.
For sure. Yeah.
Hell yeah, man! That's beautiful.
Yeah, it's dope, dude. It's dope. Yeah. Confidence is a big thing.
Yes, very big.
Experience, like having a history to be confident about, like a shared experience that you went through, where you prove to yourself you can do it, and then you're like, that's one pat on the back. Keep moving. Like it's a little push. Like next time, like remember you did. And I was like, yeah. You're right. Okay, I can do this. I can do this. And then you build.
Hell yeah.
See, this podcast is good for me, man. See? I know.
Yeah.
It's feeling like it's secretly like trick me into feeling like creative and like good again.
It's not a trick, man. That's real. You're manifesting it.
Yeah.
Through your thoughts and your mind.
Yeah. Through conversation, though.
You're going through
it. That's how it's working. Yeah.
I feel that, man. You know what's one thing I've been thinking about, man? I really want to make something, you know, something that I want. I've been, you know, working on, but I want to like, I want to go through every step of the way, like right, like confidently, and like know what I want and like get it done, like and not worry about like timing. Like, I don't know. Yeah. I want to go through like the pre-production. I want to go with me writing this thing every month, maybe like two words. Yeah. And then maybe in a year I have something that I can show you and you'll be like, all right, there it is. But like you have all the shit you got to work on. So, and I keep working on it. And then I'm like, I have a script that I'm happy with and other people are happy with. And like, I don't know, that I'm like, maybe I can make something. And then I go to, you know, get a casting director. I go to get, I don't know, like every piece of the puzzle and go through every single thing and go through like getting those takes, like when it comes to set and like actually doing rehearsals all the time. Like, cause I never, I honestly never went through that yet. And I really want to do that. Like a lot of the things I've made are very like, it's not like rushed, but like there's a deadline and it's not really like a realistic kind of thing. So sometimes I end up rushing, you know, and I really want to just do something out of the love and like, I don't know, the time that I want to put in the time. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. With that comes confidence too.
Yeah.
I think you're going to surprise yourself if you do it that way. I think you, by the end of it,
whenever it's the most rewarding.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, dude. Yes, bro. Yes. No matter what, like there'll be like pressures to like, where's your film? You know, I want to get it out before this festival. I want to submit it to this thing. I want to get distribution. We need to cast by this day. Otherwise, if you don't start with story first and like whatever it takes to do that and then work into the next phase of it, whatever it takes to do that and not rush this motherfucker, you're going to be so rewarded by the end of the process because you're going to be so proud of your product.
Yeah.
Whatever it is. And like you're going to share a story that means something to you because you put so much time and effort into it.
Hell yeah.
And not like rushed effort, but like, just like, I really love for the love of the game, you know, because I love doing this.
Like if Fincher's sitting there doing those 50 takes, like he's not, you know what I mean? He's trying to also, he's trying to get the take.
Yeah. And that motherfucker loves making films, I'm sure. Yeah. Like it's about the journey. It's not really about the
energy. That just sounds so like, I don't know, like inspiring, I guess. Motivating for me to like find that moment where you're like, fuck man, we're doing this.
Yeah, dude. Yes, dude.
We're going to do it. I'm going to do it. You're going to do it. We're all going
to
do it.
That's right. It's a lot of work to get to that moment. Yeah, and it's worth it. That like going through the journey and the ups and downs of it and like the struggle of it. There was so much struggle getting to the day of like laying in that bed and like doing that scene where we're just talking to feel like, oh my God, I'm the luckiest man in the world, dude. I'm experiencing like the one thing I wanted to do 10 years ago with a person I didn't know before. Now I do. And with a group of people around me that I didn't know at that time, now I do. And we're just telling stories together that, you know, I care about so much and that other people seem to care about too. And like, what? I couldn't have said at 20 or 19 or 18, like, that's going to be my life. Like, I know it. I was so afraid and so not confident in that happening. And it was little tiny things that I loved doing it so, or I wanted to do it so much for the love of it, that a little thing would happen. I would try a little thing, step out of my comfort zone a little bit, and it would take a year for me to get, you know, try a new thing or like work on something 2 years, but I would do it, swing, miss a lot, hit once and be like, okay, next thing, you know, however long this takes, I don't know. And then the next thing would come through like opportunity and circumstance or whatever, or me putting in my own effort. And you do a thing you're not comfortable with, or you do a thing that's new to you. And you're like, now you got two things that you're confident in yourself about that you didn't have at 20. It's all about growth. And like, and then once you go through all that experience, like 10 years of experience, and then you're in a situation, you met a bunch of people through this thing that you do, like, because you love it. You're doing a thing you love together with other people that love to do it too, because they see it in you. It's just a beautiful process, man.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, it's worth it. It's all worth it for this. No matter what happens with the film or what, you know, whatever problems we come across, like, this moment's really cool, isn't it? And then you have that memory for the rest of your life. I think like when I'm old, or like whenever the time is for me, like when it's up, I'm going to reflect on like those kind of bookmark, like beautiful moments in my life. That, like, a lot of them have come with filmmaking. A lot of them come with acting. A lot of them have come with acting, dude. Yeah. A lot of them. Not all of them, but definitely. A lot of them.
Hell yeah. What a great way to end it.
Yeah, dude. What Thank a
great
you
way to end this, dude.
I'm coming out next week.
Yeah?
Hell yeah, I'm gonna not out, maybe, out into the world.
If it's like, a nice day, if it's a nice day, we're doing an outdoor.
Oh man. Okay.
Secluded place?
We'll be really fine. Secluded. Yeah.
We'll be fine.
I'm down. Really secluded though.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Well, that's episode 63 of the podcast.
63.
Thank you guys so much for listening and watching. Episode 63. You can find the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube with the video, Anchor.fm, Google Podcasts, Earworm, www.earpodcast.co. We cannot afford DM.
Yes.
My name's Mike, and I'm signing out.
And I'm Dave, and I love you all. You know it.
Mwah.
Mm. Mwah. 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 Mwah.